way. He makes statements, I am statements, like I am the bread of life, I am the light of the world, I'm the vine, the shepherd. And he makes those statements seven times. Seven times he kind of uses that I am pattern. And over the next few weeks, that's what we want to do. We want to look at those seven occasions. Could I ask for that light to be switched off? Thank you very much. I don't want the shine from my head to dazzle too many people. All right. So over the next seven weeks or so, we're going to look at those I am phrases that Jesus said. So before we do, let's pray. Father God, we come to your words, recognizing that we need your Holy Spirit to direct our thoughts and our minds. So help us, we pray, to understand what these words mean. Amen. As we've already said, the title, as it were, or the theme for this morning is that little verse, before Abraham was born. In some versions, it simply says, before Abraham was, I am. There is knowing what it says, and there's also knowing what it means. And the two are very different, aren't they? Knowing what it says can be very different from knowing what it means. There was a couple, I've told this story before, but it's a favorite story. There was a couple who were having a dinner party, a kind of posh little dinner party at their house. All the guests were sitting around the table, all nicely dressed. The kids were safely upstairs in bed. And they start having polite conversation over dinner when suddenly the door to the dining room opens and one little head, one of the children's, the head pops around the door. And then the other head pops around the door. And then the children appear completely naked, smothered in what looks like face cream. And the mum and the dad are so mortified. They're so embarrassed. They don't know what to do. Well, how do you handle this? You know, there you are, all posh and polite. And you're there with friends perhaps you don't know so well. And then your children appear in the room naked, smothered in face cream. What do you do? You know what they did? They just kept going. They pretended as if nothing had happened. They pretended there were no children there, and they just kept the polite conversation going. Now, the guests realized how embarrassed the hosts were, and they basically thought, well, all right, well, if that's what they've decided to do, we'll pretend as well. So everybody around the table pretended that the children weren't there. And the children, completely naked, smothered in face cream, just wander around the room. Right round the table, and they get back to the door and they wander out again. And as they are going out of the dining room door, one turns to the other and says, "See, I told you it was vanishing cream." There is knowing what it says, and there is knowing what it means. The kids read the label or whatever, vanishing cream, and they knew what it said, but they didn't know what it means. What is Jesus saying here in John chapter 8? And most important, what does it mean? Jesus is making two points. And if you miss these two points, they've already been brought out in the children's talk. You can't, I think, leave today missing these two points. The two points are this. He's talking about pre-existence. He's saying, I existed before. He's also taking the most intimate name of God as his own. And Leah brought that out brilliantly. He's taking the most intimate name of God as his own. This is what he says in verse 58. Very truly, in other words, I'm being as honest with you. I say that phrase. My dad used to tell me off for saying that. You know, I say, to be honest. And then he'd say to me, does that mean the rest of the time you're not honest? This is that sort of phrase here. Very truly. In other words, I'm giving you the absolute truth. Before Abraham was born, I am. Jesus is talking about pre-existence. He existed before Abraham. There's a dispute. If you read John chapter 8, there's a dispute going on all the way sort of through the chapter. And it's been rumbling on through John chapter 8. The Jews are basically saying, we're children of Abraham. We don't need you. In fact, in verse 48, they call him a demon-possessed Samaritan. They're saying, look, you're not from God, and you're certainly not one of us. You're a demon-possessed Samaritan. Now, in verse 39, Jesus tells them, look, you're not really children of Abraham. Oh, you're biological children of Abraham, yes. But in terms of faith, children of Abraham, no. You're not really children of God. If you were children of Abraham, if you were children of God, you'd listen to me. You'd welcome me. And that comes out all the way through John chapter 8. And then he says this in verse 56. Your father Abraham rejoiced at the thought of seeing my day. He saw it and was glad. Now the Jews hear this. And they say, hold on a sec. Abraham lived 2,000 years ago. And you're saying, in a way, that you're saying you've seen him, you've talked to him, he's seen you, and he's rejoicing at the fact that he has. Are you greater than Abraham? Now, those questions come out before. This is exactly what Jesus was claiming, to be greater than Abraham, to exist before Abraham. And then to put it beyond any doubt, kind of to knock the question for six, he says, before Abraham existed, there was me. And he uses that phrase, which is loaded with meaning, I am. Before Abraham was born, I am. Some people have said, oh, you read the Bible, and Jesus never really claims to be God. Oh, you're missing the point. He claims very definitely in all sorts of ways to be God. He claims omnipresence. When three of you gather together to pray, I'm there in the middle. Only God is there, because if there's a few over there praying, there's a few over there praying. Basically, Jesus is saying, I'm all those places. When he says this phrase, before Abraham existed, I am. Before Abraham was born, I am. He is clearly stating that he is Yahweh, God. So Jesus is talking about pre-existence. And then Jesus is taking the most intimate name of God as his own. Imagine a man sort of gets on a bus, just there's a bus stop just out there. He gets on a bus just out there into the town centre. He catches a train into London. And he's there with a stepladder and a screwdriver. He gets all the way onto the train. He gets all the way to London. He goes through the tube system of London with his stepladder and his screwdriver. And then he appears outside Harrods. He puts up his stepladder. He goes up to the balcony bit and he starts taking, should have a picture, he starts taking the Harrods logo down from the side of the building. Imagine someone does that. A security guard comes along. You can't do that. What are you doing? And the man says, well, I like the sign. I like the name, Harrods. It sounds expensive. It sounds quality. You've got loads of signs. I'm taking this one. And the security guard said, well, you can't do that. He said, look, I have a little shop in Aspley. I'm going to call it Harrods of Aspley. That's way better than Waitrose at Woolerton, isn't it? He said, I'm going to put this sign on Harrods in Aspley. My little shop, I'm going to put this sign on my shop. And the security guard says, hold on, you can't do that. You can't take that name. You can't take that sign because it doesn't belong to you. Call in the police. We're putting a stop to this. And he'd be absolutely right to do that. Unless, of course, this little man with his ladder and his screwdriver is actually the owner of Harrods. If he was actually the owner of Harrods, he could take that name down, he could use it, put it wherever he likes, because he's the owner of Harrods. Jesus answered them, before Abraham was born, I am. That word I am is packed with history and packed with meaning. There is knowing what it says, and there is knowing what it means. And those two are very different. The Jews who were listening to Jesus right there at the time, they didn't just know what Jesus had said, they knew exactly what he meant by it. Because in verse 59, it says they got stones and they were going to stone him to death. Right there on the spot, they wanted him dead because of what he'd said. What had they seen? What had they heard that made them react like that? Well, to understand what Jesus meant, you've got to go back, as we've already done, to Exodus chapter 3. You're going back some 1,300 years. Israel are slaves in Egypt. God calls Moses via a burning bush and tells Moses to get my people out of Egypt, and I'm going to give you a new land and I'm going to give you a new home. Moses is scared. God promises, get this, he says, I will be with you. That's not enough for Moses. Moses says, look, I need to know your name. In verse 13 of Exodus chapter 3, he said, if I go back to these people and say that you sent me, they're going to ask for your name, and I don't know it. Now, we see it's there in the Old Testament. We see it's back there in Genesis, as Leah said. The name appears over and over again from Genesis onwards. But the reality is that Moses put together and wrote Genesis and collated. And he won't, at that particular point, he did not know the name that he uses earlier on in Genesis. It's also very likely that he's asking for the name of God because he knows that a very small group of the elders of Israel have been entrusted with the intimate name of God. And that when he goes and says, I've been sent by God to release the people, they'll say, hold on a second, we've got all these other gods, which God are you actually talking about? And hold on a second, if you've really been sent by God, you'll know his intimate, his personal, as it were, name. It's very likely that it's been passed down from generation to generation. And this little group in Egypt know the name of God, almost like a secret password. Now, do your children ever do that to you? You can't go through this kitchen door until you say the secret word. What's the secret word? Smack in the chops. It's always something poo-related in our family, which is always something terrible. But in essence, the people back in Egypt kind of knew there was a name for God. There's a small group, tiny little group, that probably held and cherished that name. And when Moses comes in, he's going to need to know that name, or they're going to say, well, God didn't speak to you, because you don't even know his name. So God answers Moses and gives him, as it were, the secret password. He gives him this special name, and he says this, I am who I am. Some older versions put it this way, I am that I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. Say, I am has sent me. Verse 15 goes on, say to the Israelites, God speaking again, say to the Israelites, the Lord. Now, if you look at your Bible, it's probably all caps. And it's telling you that the word that's used is that word, Yahweh. Say to the Israelites, Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, has sent me. Do you like wordplay? I've got to be honest, I'm horrendous at spelling. I hate Scrabble and I hate wordplay. All right. But here, God is doing a bit of wordplay. Have you heard the phrase or the question? Why was six scared of seven? Have you heard that one? Do you know the answer to that? Why was six scared of seven? So children. Yes, because 7, 8, 9. And you think about it, it's a bit of wordplay, isn't it? Eight as in A-T-E, 7, 8, 9. Why was six scared of seven? Because 7, 8, 9. Bit of wordplay. Right here in Exodus, God is doing a bit of wordplay. You see, the word for I am, that sometimes is translated I will be, and the word then that also goes on to be, they're all pretty much the same sort of word. They have the same sort. And then the word Yahweh, again, the same word. The slight little variations on whether it's single or plural and all, the slight little variations, but basically that I am, that I will be, even that I'm to come, all of those little phrases are the Yahweh kind of word. So when God says to Moses, just in verse 12, I will be with you, he's kind of giving him a sneaky little preview of his name. I think that's brilliant. I will be with you is the same as I am, the same as it were as to be, the same as Yahweh. Some Bible scholars have put it this way, and I think this is kind of simplifying it. When God says, I am who I am, or I am that I am, that is God's, as it were, full name. He's telling you, that's my full name. You know, my Christian name and my surname, as it were. And when he says, I am, he's almost drawing you to the first name. Some of the scholars say it's really structured kind of like that. That name I am is saying I am timeless. I am self-existent. By name and by nature, I am. Exodus 3, it's God giving Moses his first and most intimate name. Now, I don't know the sort of people you mill around with, but let's imagine that you get to see Lord Sugar. Do you watch The Apprentice? You know what I mean from Lord? You got a picture of it? There he is. He never looks happy, does he? Anyway, imagine that you get to meet Lord Sugar, and you're going in on a business meeting at first, and you say to his aide, how am I supposed to address him? And the aide says, very particularly, you address him as Lord Sugar. All right, okay. Anyway, you get to know him over time, and you get to meet with him over time. Maybe you have, he comes to meals at your house. He you go out for meals. You play golf and snooker or whatever together. You get to hang out. There isn't really a kind of face of a person that you hang out with, really, is it there? But you get to hang out with Lord Sugar. And one day he turns to you and he says, look, you can call me Alan instead of Lord Sugar. And then imagine the relationship carries on and it develops and it gets even deeper. And one day he just says to you, look, my friends call me Al. Now, I can't imagine that. I can't imagine that at all. I can't imagine he's really got many friends. But anyway, but my friends call me Al. You call me Al. And in some way, what is going on in Exodus chapter 3 is God says, I am that I am. And then he says, I want you to tell them I am. And it's as it were, God is getting very personal about his name. It's no longer a title, the Lord or God, as we use, but I am. Jesus is taking the most intimate name of God and he's making it his own. There is knowing what it says, and there's knowing what it means. The crowd know what it means when Jesus says, I am. When he says, before Abraham was born, I am. The crowd know what it means, so they pick up stones and they want to stone him to death on the spot. He has taken, as it were, the sign from the front of Herod's, and he's made it his own. He's taken God's name and he's made it his own. Now that is not acceptable unless, of course, he's God, in which case it is perfectly acceptable, in which case it is the right thing to do. All through John 8, all through, you could say, the Gospel of John, Jesus is in essence saying, this is who I am, God in skin. Will you believe me? Will you honor me? Will you obey me? Look at verse 51. He says this, I tell you the truth. Whoever obeys my teachings will never die. He's not pointing anybody to someone else. He's pointing everybody to himself and his own teachings. Whoever obeys my teachings will never die. Whoever, anyone. Who what? Who obeys, who listens and lives by my teachings will never die. Jesus is talking about spiritual death here. Not the physical death, but the death that separates us from God. He's talking about hell, the death that is forever dying. You'll never face that. You'll never die. I tell you the truth. Whoever obeys my teaching will never die. Becoming a Christian boils down to trusting in Jesus. In taking him at his word, when he says to us, I am. When he says to us, I can bring forgiveness. When he says to us, I can pay the price for what you have done wrong. Becoming a Christian is trusting and taking Jesus at his word. I believe him. I then build the life, my life, and the direction of my life on him. Becoming a Christian boils down to trusting. Living as a Christian, once we are trusting in Jesus, is really all about obeying. It's a brilliant formula, trusting and obeying. A crucial combination, trusting and obeying. Because we trust, we obey. We obey because we trust. Trusting and obeying, a crucial combination. And Jesus is saying, look, for those people who trust and obey, you will never face death. Never face hell. In dying, you will die. Let me ask you a question just to sum up and to finish off. And it's a really important question. And it's a question that hopefully you can put everything else out of your mind and you can just ponder this question. And the question is this: are you trusting and obeying Jesus? Are you? I know obeying is a long-term work project, but it has to start with that trusting. Are you trusting and obeying Jesus? Can I beg you to take that question seriously? We are not talking about things that last 10, 20, 30 years. We're talking about things that matter for eternity. Are you trusting and obeying? Maybe right now you recognize that you need to start trusting and obeying. Maybe you already know and you can say, I've trusted and I've obeyed. There is a big difference between knowing what Jesus has said and knowing what Jesus means. Because there is a big difference. We need not just to hear the words, but know what they mean. And I deep down believe only the Holy Spirit can bring the meaning to our hearts. And if right now the Holy Spirit is working in your mind and your thoughts, and he's bringing the meaning to life, whatever you do, don't stamp that out. Allow God to speak to you. Because he wants everyone to be saved. He wants everyone trusting and obeying. Because he knows it makes the eternity of difference. What is Jesus saying here? Jesus is saying he pre-existed. He existed before Abraham. What is Jesus saying here? He's taking the very most intimate name of God and he is owning it for himself. It is like peeling the sign off Harrods and sticking it on his own shop. That is what he is doing. Do you personally understand what that means?